Any questions about this practice?
As far as I understand, the main idea of mind meditation is observing the mind. And all the process is to observe the mind. And at the same time, we are supposed also to observe the thoughts and emotions.
In the mind.
And isn't it too much at the same time to observe? When I observe the mind, I have to observe also the thought, or the mind observes the thought.
You're talking about observing the observer?
This is maybe another question. I ask first of all, if I observe the mind, okay, there is I and there is mind.
So if you observe the mind, yes, the mind. You're observing the mind.
I'm observing the mind.
Correct.
At the same time, I'm supposed to observe the thought.
So you're observing the mind and then whatever's appearing in that mind. Correct. Mind. That's right.
So, okay, but I have to observe the thought and the thoughts is an object.
Correct.
And the mind is also an object.
Correct.
So I have to look at both at the same time. My wife can do it better than me.
When we say, but we're not saying, what we're not saying is that the mind is here and the thought is here and we have to sort of go like this.
Yes, that's why I am.
So, remember, the analogy is that the mind is like the sky and the clouds are moving through the sky. So if you're looking at the sky and there's clouds moving through, are we sort of doing this? No. Either there's clouds there or there's no clouds. When there's no clouds, you see the sky. So if there's no thoughts, you see the mind. And if there's thoughts, you're observing the thought. So they're not, you're not sort of looking in two different places. They're in the same place. So I think one confusion here could be that we're seeing the mind as a thing, an object. And then often people get very confused. They go, where is this thing, the mind? That's a bit like a fish saying, where is this thing, water?
But may I observe the mind and no thoughts?
In fact, if you are observing the mind clearly, yes, and a thought arises, you'll be seeing that thought clearly. Because where the mind is, that's where the thought is. So if you have clear appearance of the mind and a thought arises, automatically you'll see the thought.
There is an overlap between the mind and the thought.
Another analogy that could be helpful here is the mind. The mind is like the ocean and the thoughts are like waves on the ocean. So when you see a wave, you're seeing the ocean. No? So the mind is not something other, the thought is not something other than the mind. The thought is an expression of the mind. So they're not two different things. You can't have a thought without the mind.
An additional question may be the same. When I observe the thought, I have the feeling that I and the mind are the same sometimes.
Okay, so the question is that when you're observing the thought, sometimes you have a feeling that I and the mind are the same thing. This, remember, is a shamatha practice. And the goal of this practice is to develop single-pointed concentration, to develop a calm, clear, focused mind, to develop relaxation, stability, clarity. That's the goal of this practice. And often in this practice, when people are observing the mind, they go, well, hang on, who is this observer? You know, am I the same as what I'm observing, or am I something different? That thinking in this practice is a fault. That thinking is what we do in Vipassana. That is Vipassana practice. Vipassana practice is exactly asking these questions. is who is the observer? Is the observer the same as the mind that's being observed, or is the observer something different? Those questions are Vipassana practice. So then we leave that till Vipassana, but we don't want to fly to Vipassana, because if we don't do this shamatha practice and we fly to Vipassana and ask these questions, we're not going to get any good answers, accurate answers. Because that would be like this shamatha practice, you know, where the Vipassana practice is a little bit like being a scientist running experiments to see, to find some, get some answers to questions. Shamatha is the equipment. So if a scientist runs an experiment on faulty equipment, they can run that experiment 100 times and get 100 different results. If we do Vipassana without shamatha, that's like that. We may get 100 different results when we ask, well, not 100, but we'll get different answers when we ask the question, who's the observer? Because we're not going to be able to clearly check that question, because our mind is not very clear and focused. It's really sort of vague. And so we'll ask that question and we may come up with different answer each time. And then we'll get no conclusion, decisive answer. Well, who is this observer? So that's why we need the shamatha for the Vipassana.
The instruction is not to hold on to a thought? Yes.
Yeah.
Not to hold on, and also not to follow up on it, and not to let it go as well, just watch it.
Not to let it go.
Right.
Okay. Well, yeah. I mean, yeah, not to let it go. We are to let it be.
Let it be.
Right. Means just watch it.
That's the confusion here, because how do I know when it's going, that like I'm letting it go, or is it going by itself?
So the question is, the confusion is, how do I know if I'm letting it be, or I'm sort of getting rid of it,
yeah,
or following it? There's three options.
Yeah.
Following, letting it be, getting rid of it.
I'm a little confused.
So that's the confusion. Of course, as a beginner, we'll have it'll be a little bit of a mixture of those. I think as a beginner, it'll be very difficult to 100% let it be and watch it, because we don't have that habit. So what's going to happen as a beginner is most likely we're going to get caught up in it and off on a story. And what will happen is, if we're fully grasping to it, we're completely lost. It's only when we let go of that that we go, oh, hang on, I'm lost. But when you realize you're lost, you're not lost anymore, of course. So what's going to happen is, initially, something will come up, grab hold of it, off we go, and then maybe some seconds or minutes later we go, oh, hang on, what am I doing here? And then we're back. And the same thing, something comes up, off we go. Seconds, minutes later, oh, back. And if we keep doing that, instead of minutes, it'll become 30 seconds, 10 seconds, 5 seconds, 1 second. And then we'll notice, as we're getting caught up, we'll notice that and let go. And eventually, we'll be able to be fully present with it. One way to know if we're really observing or getting caught up is, are the mental events that are arising, is there some sort of story unfolding? Is there some connection between one thing and another? If there is, there's some level of grasping. If that really reduces to no grasping, you'll find that the mental events will be very random. There will be no thread to them. If there's a thread, that's some grasping. But that's better than fully getting lost. Because what's happening there is, we are observing and grasping and sort of doing this. Now, of course, we just grasp and go, gone.
We always grasp, right?
Yeah, well, not always, but most often. But when we start this practice and we start to have more observing, then instead of grasping for seconds or minutes, we'll have grasping, then observing, grasping, observing. They'll be backwards and forwards a bit, and it'll be like we're sort of observing, but there's a bit of a story unfolding, but we're not caught up fully in the story. And then as there's more observing, less grasping, then it'll be less like a story and just random events. And what you'll find is that if you're really not grasping, the thoughts will go like really fast, because it's only if you grasp that they can stay. If you're not grasping, it'll die super fast. And not really any connection. It'll just be very random. So there's a whole gradient there from completely lost to observing 100%. And so, yeah, and that's the practice, to move along that gradient. And of course, as the more we get into the practice, the more we'll be able to notice that. And the more mind our, more clear our mind will become.
When you said to him grasping, you mean kidnapped?
Kidnapped, yeah. Kidnapped.
So may I say something for them? Before introducing this by you today, I'm aware of the fact that I'm the whole day my mind is manufacturing thoughts, memories, blah 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 blah. Maybe good, but a lot of machine is working.
Right.
And I'm aware of it.
Good.
That no, I'm aware of it. That from time to time I succeed in saying, be aware that you are doing ta-ta-ta, be aware that you are not nice, be aware that you are blah, blah, blah. That's what you mean?
No, so what exactly this is the point, yeah, is when that happens, you're not kidnapped fully. You have some awareness.
No, of course, in this
so what? Yeah, so exactly. So what's happening is we get kidnapped a bit, we realize that, and we're observing, then we get kidnapped again, so we're sort of doing this.
Yes.
And that's what you're explaining. So what we're saying is that if we keep going in this practice, we'll get to the point where we won't get kidnapped at all.
Is it better?
Absolutely, because when we get kidnapped, we're out of control.
But I'm exhausted anyway. So.
And it's getting kidnapped is causes the exhaustion.
Being kidnapped is exhaustion?
Because we're reacting.
I'm living in a theater. I don't need to do anything. If I just let it go, there's a whole theater in my brain all day, no?
Right. And if you see it as a theater, then there's no problem. It's getting caught up in the theater that's the problem. If we don't get, if we see it as a theater, a show, we're free of it. And what will happen is we're not feeding that show, because we have to feed the show, we have to get caught up in it. So if we're not feeding the show, over time, the show will go and our mind will become still, which means then we're in control. We can turn on the show whenever we need it, instead of the show causing problems for us. Our mind can be quiet, and then we're in charge. We decide when we need to think and act.
So you mean that
now the mind is in charge, we're the slave.
So the mind...
We get kidnapped.
We're kidnapped. So yeah. You mean to say that at this stage that you're describing, the mind will not manufacture all this production?
Only when we want it to. We need it to.
If I don't need it, what will be?
Quiet.
Are you serious?
Really? Down there. Yeah.
I just wanted to share that, that the multiple instructions on what to focus this time were very, very helpful for me. And I felt like that I stayed in focus the whole 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I could focus on the objective. And in a certain point, I realized that I'm flashing. I could literally feel the emotion behind it, and I could separate it to see the thought itself, and the emotion arises, and mm-hmm. It gave me it makes sense of, well, can it be separated, like one object and another? another, and it gave me an inner feeling of like hope of freedom, like something like that. I never thought it can be, I can split between.
Yeah. So
on the background, I was very aware to the rhythm of the breath the whole time, and like things were very organized and very what the background, what's the in front, and the anchor of the breath. It was like
very good. So, yeah, so as you were saying, then the anchoring in, particularly the rhythm, I think the rhythm of the breath is very helpful, and particularly for the practice that we're going to do tomorrow, we'll also, if we want, can use that rhythm of the breath for anchoring in tomorrow's practice as well. And it really can give us a very good anchor into this practice so we don't get caught up. And so, again, as you said, I think it's very helpful to distinguish between a certain event and our reaction to that event, because often they seem like, you know, if there's an event, then reaction is part of that, and we feel like stuck, that every time something happens to us, that reaction is part of that. But actually it's not. There's something appearing and then our reaction. And to notice that is the first step of stopping to react to that usually difficult situation or something. So very good. Behind first and then.
Sometimes when I observe my thoughts, it's very tempting to analyze. Especially when I'm trying to distinguish between thoughts and emotion and see the connections and
yeah.
See my reactions.
So remember, analyzing these things is a valid form of vipassana practice, to look at the causes and conditions for certain things arising. That's very helpful. But here, of course, in the shamatha practice, that's not the right time to do it. So just when that desire to analyze comes up, just observe that desire, that wanting to analyze. That's another mental event. Just observe that. Just notice that. You wanting to figure it out. Just notice that.
Twice today, I think I was very disobedient in a way.
You were disobedient.
Yeah. After yoga in the morning, we came here to meditation, and I focused on the nostrils and the air. But then, after a while, I just went into the rhythm of the and at first it was watching the rhythm of the breath, but then the breath became very subtle. And I couldn't feel, I felt it as if I wasn't breathing. So there was a thought coming, so, OMG, I'm not breathing. So it was really like frightening. And then when it came, the breathing was of course very, very deep.
Yeah.
And then again, it was a quite a long one, I think 45 minutes, the whole thing, so it has time to do that.
Sure.
And then it felt as if, it's very difficult for me to conceptualize it, but it wasn't an illusion, it was just a feeling that as if air was here, and it just came into my body like sun rays on a flower, right? So it was very subtle, I could hardly feel that I'm alive, so I suppose I was breathing.
Sure,
so this is one
yeah.
thing. So I was wondering what was that. And the other was today, when we focused on the mind, and you said, observe your own mind. And in a sense, it put me in a certain place inside that was this observer. You were talking about this me. So I was very disobedient and didn't listen to that, and I just said to myself, observe the mind, not in general. And what happened is that I couldn't feel anymore where the mind was, and the thoughts were not my thoughts or anyone. I didn't know where they came from or went to, but it was something, it was very curious.
Mm-hmm.
and it was very similar to this sensation of the breath. So I don't want to invent any practice. I just want to practice what I have.
Sure. Yeah. So I think both of your comments there are connected, and they are, I think, both related to this releasing this false sense of grasping onto me. Of course, we're eliminating that false sense of grasping in Vipassana practice, but already here in Shamatha practice, that false sense of grasping can go very dormant. And that can result in a number of different experiences. One is that whether we're using the breath or observing the mind, there's not really a sense of an agent anymore. There's just sort of the breathing happening. There's just the movie going on. There's not really an observer. There's just that happening. So that's a sign that our mind is getting more focused. And due to that, the grasping is becoming more dormant because of that, because we're more focused on that activity than the agent who's doing it. So the grasping is very much reduced. So that is a thing there. And also, and we're going to talk more about this tomorrow in relation to tomorrow's practice, is that often when this happens, one of the most common experiences is fear. A lot of fear arises. And the reason is, and we'll talk more about this tomorrow, is that our normal sense of identity is constantly reinforced by solid body and blah, 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 blah all the time. That's the sense of me. So in this practice, when we get focused on the rhythm of the breath or focused on the mind, solid sense of body can disappear. And a lot of the blah, blah, blah can go quiet. And then all of a sudden, all you've got is some rhythm of the breath or stillness of the mind. And then our normal sense of identity is gone. And usually the most common response to that is fear. Because it seems like the only me we've identified our entire life is this. This me with a solid body and lots of chit-chat. Suddenly it's not there. And we feel like either I don't really exist or I'm going out of existence. But we'll talk more about that tomorrow. So if the fear arises, you can simply ask the question, who's having the fear? Because if there's no you, there can be no fear. So the fact that fear is arising proves you exist. So no need to worry about that. And we'll talk about that also in more detail when we look at the Vipassana practice later. I think we've got time for one or two more questions, yeah.
During the mind meditation we did earlier today, I was getting more and more dull. Like, and when I was on the verge of falling asleep, the thoughts started to have the texture of a dream. It was like a play with the weird story and characters and everything. And it happened to me with this meditation before. I was like almost asleep, but still a little aware, so I could like see it. But then usually I just space out where the story gets cut. So do you think that might be like connected to lucid dreaming somehow?
So the question is, when we're going into a lot of dullness, we have this sort of spacey sort of story unfolding.
Yeah.
Could that be connected to lucid dreaming?
If you're still manage to stay aware.
So, of course, what's happening here is we are drifting into dullness, but we have some mindfulness of that dullness. Because normally we don't have the mindfulness and then that dullness just goes into more or less sleep. But because we're having mindfulness, we're starting to notice that dullness. And so then often those mental events that go on at that level before, we don't even notice it, we're just like completely... But now we're starting to notice it, and they have a bit of a dreamy sort of quality to them. So that's fine, so just notice that, notice the dullness, be mindful of the dullness, and then you'll find that you can sharpen that focus. And of course, in a dream, we don't know we're dreaming, And lucid dreaming is becoming aware during the dream. So there is some sort of vague similarity there, that a lucid dream, we're aware of the dream, and here we're starting to become aware of these mental events at that low, dull state, which we're normally not aware of. Last question. Is one, of course, is if you're bored, observe the boredom, because that's a mental event. So observe that boredom, and again, what we can do is often when the mind goes quiet, often it can be because we're sort of sinking into this sort of dullness. It's a very nice state, it's quiet and that, but so what we can do then is pay closer attention to sharpen the focus without tightening. So just sharpen your focus, pay closer and closer interest, like be curious about that state and pay closer and closer attention without tightening. And then just see what happens. Okay. Yeah, last question.
I felt last meditation that I have a lot of quarrels with myself, that I'm talking to
So again, if we fight with our mind, it's like throwing petrol on the fire, it just gets worse. So we don't have to fight with our mind. All we need to do is just step back and watch. And if we watch the mind, we're free of the mind, which means no matter what comes up, it can't harm us, because we're just watching it. And so we just step back and watch. And if you find yourself starting to fight with that, observe that. Observe the reaction in your mind. Observe the aversion, the wanting to get rid of that, or the reaction to it. Just observe that reaction. Okay, dinner time, so let's leave it there. And this evening, and we'll come back at 7:30 in the evening.